Selena are the same. Split right down the center.
I'm ready, Max. I've been down here too long. It's time for me to ascend, to reemerge.
On the second one, it was always the desire to kind of do something else, but still keeping the spirit of Batman. I mean, we wouldn't want to change it to where all of a sudden it was a completely different thing. But, you know, you're working with other writers, designers, actors, artists. You're not, myself included, don't want to just do the same thing. So everything was slightly redesigned or completely redesigned or rethought, but it's always trying to keep within some idea of the Batman that we first made.
Tim and I had talked about it. We figured we had this pretty well wired, you know, what I did, what I didn't do, what I needed to do, what I absolutely didn't need to do, what was better for me not to do. And we thought, well, this will actually be easy. This will be one of those where you just show up, you know, turn around, look into camera, and kind of spray a little sweat on your face like you just beat up five guys and go home. It turned out it wasn't like that. At all.
It did have a darkness and a complexity and a resonance that I think the audience at the times, a lot of people didn't expect. You know, it wasn't just kind of a fun, cool comic book movie. It was something more than that.
You didn't invite me, so I crashed!
Tim and I had several kind of loose conversations about where the movie would go with input from the studio. They really wanted the Penguin because they sort of saw the Penguin as the number two Batman villain. We wanted to do Catwoman, so we wound up doing Penguin and Catwoman. And I did two drafts. It was a deal where the studio was now at the point where they wanted to proceed with the movie. And they said, Tim, come on, are you gonna do it? You gonna do it or not gonna do it? And Tim was very averse at the end of the day to the idea of coming in and doing a sequel because he thought he'd kind of, you know, look, I've shot my wad on Batman. I've said what I have to say about Batman. I don't really know if I want to do this. And he was very reluctant to get involved. And finally, the way that they kind of got to him was to say, well, what if the second movie is really just a Tim Burton movie? And that kind of got his attention and got him thinking about what he could do with it again. You know, how extreme could you go with the Penguin? How extreme could you go with Catwoman? What if you didn't have to worry about, you know, sort of the fidelity to the mythology, all of that kind of stuff like that.
I wouldn't have done it right after the first one because that was like the last thing you'd want to do was go right into another one of those. So I did Edward Scissorhands after Batman, which was nice, sort of different kind of experience, which was great. But then I was still intrigued by the other characters, you know, like Catwoman, you know, came to mind right away because that's next to the Joker, that was probably my favorite second villain in the piece. And then that got us to thinking about, well, the Penguin, you know, you could find the psychological profile of Batman, Catwoman, Joker, but the Penguin was just this guy with a cigarette, and a top hat, you know, and didn't really, what is he? So, but then started thinking about, you know, Catwoman, Batman, sort of this animal people and Penguin, and started to think about him, trying to find a profile for him. And so it was fun to kind of come up with the sort of bad freak, you know, but again, that duality of somebody who's been sort of wronged and you know, has that sort of split not like dark, but sort of human animal, you know, and sort of using the animal motif as a strong image for the film. And then I started to get excited about it.
Well, once we decided, you know, that Tim was going to direct the sequel, you know, we jumped right in with the script. So it was, I mean, it was challenging. It was not an easy screenplay to develop.
Most of the stuff that I had done for that movie wound up being scrapped. And the decision that came out of that was just basically to go with pretty much a whole new direction with the story.
Tim and I never had a conversation about, like, what are fans of the comic book going to think? What are the people going to think? What are the sponsors who, you know, have promotions connected to the movie going to think of this movie? We never had those conversations. We never thought about it. I mean, we were really just about the art. We surprisingly got very little directives from the studio, like, you must have, Robin. And there was none of that, really. I think we did try it. We did try something. And Tim was big on not making a big deal about it. Like, we wanted to work in maybe a Robin character. I could tell he was not enthusiastic about it from the get-go. But we wanted more of a thing where it was kind of like something that would be hinted at and then developed in a later movie.
At some point, there was a discussion of Robin, and again, the only way I could see it was to try to find a profile that worked. But what ended up happening was, again, I think at the end of it all, we just realized we had too many characters, and you know, people can complain, even without Robin, they complain that there maybe is too many characters, you know, and always with, you know, there was always the idea that third or fourth, you know, I mean, at this point, I think Warner saw it as a potentially ongoing thing, maybe, and therefore, you know, there's always that, well, if we don't do it in this one, they'll do it in the next one kind of deal.
You know, what Tim is able to do is make characters that are mythic. He is able to connect with them on an emotional level and make them real and grounded, so that even though they seem to be, you know, otherworldly or larger than life, their emotions are real and relatable.
More than any other person who's interpreted Batman, that I really think that Tim Burton has the most in common with Batman.
I remember hearing things like, oh, you know, in the first movie, you know, the Joker stole the show, and in the second movie, you know, he's hardly in it, it's all the Catwoman and Penguin. And I always felt that those people, for me, were missing the point of the character of Batman, you know, what he is. That's why I didn't like Robin involved, just because this guy wants to remain as hidden as possible and in the shadows as possible and unrevealing about himself as possible. So, you know, all of those things, you know, he's not going to eat up screen time by these big speeches and doing, you know, dancing around the Batcave, you know. I always felt he was in at the right amount and the right sort of level of him.
Hey, Mark. Okay. And action!
We really wanted Michael Keaton to be Batman and Bruce Wayne again. I mean, you know, it's always hard, I think, for an actor to commit to playing the same character over and over again. They have to feel confident that they have something more to bring, you know, to the character. And, you know, Michael definitely struggled with that and questioned it, which I think was good. You know, it pushed us to really make sure that the character, you know, reached the level of the first movie.
I think Michael was game for it. I think he was probably game for it the same reason I was, which is, you know, he'd done the character and got to kind of revisit it with other actors and other people, other situations. So, you know, I think that was probably the lure for him. I don't think it was the joy of climbing back into the suit, you know, but I think it was for those reasons, probably.
The only challenge I thought of before I started was the mere fact that I had never done to a character twice. So I was interested in doing that. What I hadn't anticipated was that I was into my second or third day, I realized something seemed a little off, and what I think I was doing was imitating myself. You're playing the same character, so I had to keep thinking, well, I've played this character, so what does he do here? And I excluded any other possibilities. So once I found myself saying, okay, this seems like what he would do here, but it doesn't sound right and it doesn't feel very right. So I found myself kind of doing an impersonation of myself, which was, first of all, impossible, and second of all, really strange. And so I just dropped that and said, no, you gotta just open up like it's the first time and just trust that, you know, the character will be there, I guess.
It was really fun, you know, casting this movie. What a dream come true to have to cast the Penguin and Catwoman in one movie, you know? And I think everybody always just automatically said Danny DeVito's a Penguin. Who else is gonna be the Penguin?
There was a piece in the paper. Somebody said, wouldn't it be cool if Danny played the Penguin? And I looked at it and went, wow, you know, I never thought about that. That's how I sort of got introduced to it.
Danny was the first and only choice for that. There's no question about it.
And action, Danny!
Forward! March! The liberation of Gotham has begun!
Jim creates that great atmosphere, that world of, like, where you feel like everything is an invention. Tim did a painting that he gave me. It was very colorful, kind of circus tent, and there was a boy sitting in front of it that was Oswald as a toddler. He didn't have hands, he had, you know, flippers, and he's kind of rotund and small, and he had kind of a weird pointed features, and the caption read, "My name is Jimmy, but they call me the hideous penguin boy." It was a great image to start from.
He kind of became the character and was the Penguin throughout the movie, on and off the set.
He stays in character all the time, and it's really creepy.
I really got to eat a lot of raw fish. It was great. I always liked sushi, but this was really spectacular. Raw and cold and just fresh. Tasty. They were really good. God, my mouth is watering. What time is it?
I mean, if somebody put their fingers too close to his mouth, he might just take it off.
Electroshock therapy. What a bargain.
We initially had cast Annette Bening as Catwoman, and you know, did wardrobe things and all sorts of fittings and stuff. And really close to shooting, I got a call one morning and, you know, sort of this long pause on the phone, and she, you know, said she was pregnant, and I was like I've never had like such a split mixed feeling in my life. I was like very extremely happy for her, and then was like dropping down a dark abyss at the same time.
And it was kind of a crazy period, because I would say every single actress from 20 to 45 on the planet wanted to be Catwoman, and we were kind of barraged.
Sean Young, who had originally been set to play the lead in the first picture, wanted very much to do the Catwoman. And she appeared in cat costume one day at the studio.
I thought that it would work to be sort of like aggressive in the sense that that's what Catwoman would have done. She would have just gone, and she would have gone in there, and that's just what I did. I did like a major kind of Catwoman adventure.
The next thing I knew, my office door flew open, which tells you about the difference in security these days. And Michael Keaton and I saw Sean Young dressed as Catwoman leap over my sofa and say, "I am Catwoman." We looked at each other and went, whoa.
I was only told about it. But the eyewitnesses, I believe. I don't think it was a UFO sighting or, the legend of Bigfoot kind of a situation. I think the resources are fairly reliable.
When Michelle Pfeiffer expressed an interest, something just clicked where we thought, you know, she's perfect. She also could be both Selina Kyle and Catwoman.
I met with Tim, and I found him very unusual and interesting, and he explained the part to me. And I thought it would be a couple of scenes and probably, you know, not a fully developed character. Then to my surprise, I read the script and I found she was just very, actually more complicated than I could have even imagined, just sort of psychologically. And even now people say to me, now, is she a bad guy or is she a good guy? And the reason that is because the character always was kind of going from one side to the other. And I think that she was always good at heart, but was always running astray.
Well, I tried to lick her, but they didn't put that in. The Penguin is very interested in getting close to that pussycat.
The movie was very much shot out of sequence. So it was a challenge to know where I was half the time. And also, it's real ensemble, so every scene, every moment counts. You don't have a whole movie to develop a whole character. So it was actually one of the most challenging roles I've done.
I wanted to talk to her about it before we started, because I kind of wanted to warn her about what she was in for. But I didn't, and I could only offer sympathy, really, you know, and because there's no suggestion. You can't say, well, you know, here's the way I deal with this kind of picture.
She was very impressive. I mean, two things that impressed me extremely was when the cats were kind of bringing her back to life, her sort of eye flutter and her eyes opening up. I still find that really chilling and amazing. And then that moment where, you know, she put a live bird in her mouth and held it there for several seconds and then let it fly out. I mean, I don't know too many people that would do that. She did it several times. And no bird or person was injured.
Here, look at this. Bob Kane, excellent.
Penguin, Catwoman, Joker. It's an early one.
The Joker, the Penguin,
Robin,
Catwoman.
Batmobile.
The thing that changed from the first to the second was that whole dynamic of the franchise mentality. And so unlike the first one, before I start the second one, you know, toy companies and t-shirt makers and, you know, are asking, well, what's this character gonna look like? I was having these meetings where, you know, I was like, well, we haven't designed the character yet.
You know, the prep of this film was pretty enormous. Just the set of Gotham City, you know, detailed, beautiful, stylistic set. Beau Welch did an amazing job on this sort of neo-expressionistic, Germanic city that had such character and really was a character in the movie. And you know, we wanted it to be winter and Christmas and to actually snow inside the soundstage.
The challenge was is to create the atmosphere that this is going to be in. And that was about air conditioning sound stages down to a certain temperature and getting the breath and also creating an atmosphere for these real penguins.
The second one was more difficult in the sense that we had weather conditions. You know, we had to cool down the sets for the penguins. So, you know, we were in like 100 degree weather, you know, people in shorts in LA, and we're coming out of the stages in parkas and snow gear, you know, and we have three people in full, you know, costume makeup, you know, and dealing with all of that stuff. But again, you know, it's the actors and the people that keep you going, really.
What was fun about working with Tim was he actually was improvisational about his direction. And he actually did respond to what the actors brought to the space in rehearsal.
Yeah.
He doesn't have a cookbook approach to the shooting of it. His way of covering a scene wasn't conventional. It wasn't like close-ups, over-the-shoulder shots, matching sizes. He did have a sense of how he wanted to edit, and there weren't that many choices. He really couldn't cut it like a dozen different ways because it wasn't covered that way.
In the morning, I was sort of like on this assembly line, and I would be handed from one person to the next, and I felt like I was in Oz. Just my character was such a huge production every day, and it's not even to say what's going on with Danny, what's going on with Michael, what's going on with the set. You know, they're moving buildings around, and I would get lost on the stage all the time because I would walk and they would have moved everything around and I could never find my way to the set. That's never happened to me before.
The first couple days, it was really fun to watch the expression on Danny DeVito's and Michelle's faces because they just looked absolutely lost. And it was kind of like sadistically funny to me because I knew exactly what they were going through.
We tried to keep it so that Oswald was not just exposed to everybody on the set, on the lot, so they had this little thing. Tim made a kind of a canopy with the art department that I'd travel to the set in this little kind of circus canopy. It was good because you could stay in character. You could just be Oswald. And everybody respected Oswald. They kept their distance, but the crew and the other members of the cast and everybody was really, you know, into it. And they were very respectful.
About every 15th day, that's usually where it rolls around with me, that I'm just kind of standing there waiting and I kind of look at what everybody's wearing. I look at myself. And it gets really tremendously absurd, you know, where you kind of step outside yourself and you realize this is really nuts what we're doing and really kind of goofy. It's really a strange experience, and instead of kind of saying, I've made an enormous mistake here, you just gotta kind of laugh and say, well, here we go. It was more fun to see two other people do it, because at first, you know, I looked at Jack and, you know, reminded him now and then that we're both grown men doing this. He just wanted to check in every once in a while. But this time I figured, hey, if I go down, I'm going down with two other people. So, you know, we're all going down in dumb suits.
Felt like Elvis walking into Caesar's.
Yeah, I mean, people would start to laugh, but it would be for different reasons. Some reasons would be just the absurdity of it. I think some of it was just exhaustion and, like, insanity. But it was easier for me to laugh because I'm looking at him from the outside, looking at the whole thing. And so sometimes I'd start laughing and they probably thought, like, what am I laughing about? It's not funny, you know, why don't you get in this costume? But there was some catching themselves in the mirror and seeing what was going on kind of thing. But to their credit, they always kept it, you know, they found the right level of keeping it real and finding the humor when it was there.
I had an experience with a monkey, which was like harrowing. We were doing the scene in the lair when Batman sends a note with this little kind of rhesus monkey. We were doing this rehearsal and the monkey's coming down and the monkey's like got the note and the trainer's there and he says, you better, you know, look, go over and you know, get the note from the monkey. I go over to the monkey and I take the note. He hands me the note. And I give it to the trainer, and the trainer gives it back, and they say, okay, this is fine, we can shoot. Now I get into character. Oswald is not, it's not me going over, grab, be gentle with the monkey. I see a monkey come down, and I start walking over with a note, right? And the monkey comes halfway down, sees me, and goes berserk, you know, and we did it again. We went back and, you know, did it again. And the monkey got kind of used to me. And, you know, we're very friendly now, the monkey and I. We spent last weekend at Shutters at the beach.
Obviously, I like the fact that it, you know, there's no pre-sound. Uh-huh. It's just, you know, happened. Keep the shock of the explosion there.
You know, in terms of the post-production of the movie, it was really kind of scary because we had a summer release date. You know, you have to release these movies in the summer. You know, we had a very tight schedule. And this was, you know, 13 years ago now. We were in production and, you know, it was before computerized editing. It was before all these, you know, CGI techniques that we have today. It was very different. Very different time in terms of making a special effects movie. And it was kind of touch and go for a few weeks there. Would we get the film ready? But, you know, we pulled it off. We pulled it off almost to the last minute.
There was one shot at the end that I think cost like $250,000, and we had to do it on a weekend with the Catwoman, keeping her alive. I think it was something like that at the end. It was a studio note.
I remember saying, I don't think it can be done in the meeting. We'll try. And then it was a flurry of phone calls after that. Literally, it was the next day or even that afternoon that we got a Catwoman suit out of storage and put it on somebody and actually shot. Yeah, it was that quick. It was like a nightmare.
Always these big Hollywood movies, you're, you know, riding to the end of the thing. And I just decided to put that in because it just felt right. You know, I just, something about it you know, not a big deal, but just a kind of a little question about things. And I don't know, since I'd ended the last one with Batman up there, there's something about something ending with somebody else up there since he was down there, you know. And like the whole thing about cats and the whole nine lives thing and the sort of mystical quality of cats and is it real? Is it, you know, is there a slight supernatural aspect to cats and things like that, you know, sort of seem to fit the material.
You know, when you put these things together, you don't really know what it's about. You're looking at the trees and not always the forest, and that's the big challenge in what we do. So when it's finally together, especially with Tim's movies, who is really, because he comes from an animation background, he more has a clearer idea of what the end result is, compared to a lot of directors who are very talented but find their way to that end.
I know I've seen the movie with audiences much more than Tim has, that like I actually go to like a lot of the theaters, and it was always great. The lights coming up after Batman Returns, and it was like, you know, kids crying, you know, people acting like they'd been punched in the stomach and like they'd been mugged. But, you know, part of me relished that reaction, and part of me, like, to this day, like, oops, you know.
One person would come in and go, oh, this is so much lighter than the first movie. And the next person come and go, oh, this is so much darker than the first movie. And it's like, well, light and dark are, you know, they're opposites. So it's like, how can something be, and it was like 50% passionately one way, passionately the other. And I thought, this is an odd dynamic. This is quite interesting.
I remember like one write-up, I think it was in the USA Today, that basically panned the movie and said it looked like it was shot in an inkwell, which I guess it's really a compliment, you know, but at the same time, I don't know that I took it as a compliment. I took it as really kind of a criticism or a put down of the movies, because I don't think it came out to generally good reviews, even though it was the number one movie. But a lot of people accused the storyline not being developed or meaningful in some kind of way. So I thought it was a bit misunderstood.
I did hear of a somewhat of a backlash that it was too gross, you know, black. We can't have black stuff coming out of his mouth.
The movie itself, apart from, you know, being a merchandising machine, you know, apart from all the toy sales that it's supposed to generate, the movie itself was never presented as, you know, a child-friendly movie. And so I just think it's a mistake of perception. I think, you know, the parents who complained just got it wrong. But there was no, you know, there was no attempt to deceive anyone.
I really dig the fact that even now I can, you know, kids come up to me and if they don't know that I played the Penguin, once they do, you know, they're really, you know, charmed by it and taken by it. So you get into that kind of milieu of it all, and you say, yeah, it's great to be part of it. I'm really happy to be part of the Batman family.
I remember toying with the idea of doing another one, and I remember going into Warner Brothers and having a meeting. I'm going, you know, we could do this, we could do that, and they go like, Tim, don't you want to do like a smaller movie now, you know, just something that's more, and like about, you know, half hour into the meeting, I go, you don't want me to make another one, do you? And they go, oh, no. And I just said, no, I know you did. And so we just stopped it right there.
You know, when you're a director like Tim and you have so many stories to tell and you're so visionary, I mean, can you do the same character over and over again? I think we all knew that, you know, Tim had other places to go and other films to make. Would have been great for the audience because he would have made a lot of great Batman movies. But we wouldn't have had, you know, all these great films that he's made since then.
Gotta fly!